Imagine making your F1 debut for a backmarker team that goes bankrupt mid-season, and then the next year being signed by the best team on the grid. Imagine being fired by your team because you're such a liability, and then going on to win the F1 World Championship for that very same team before you leave. And then imagine being the person who starts the chain of events, which sees the most successful team on the grid become a backmarker years later. All of those statements individually sound crazy. All of those statements together sound insane. But in fact, not only did all of those things happen, but they somehow managed to happen to one driver. Here is the story of an F1 career that made absolutely no sense. The career of Damon Hill.
He took the lead, he stayed there, and Damon Hill exits the chicane and wins the Japanese Grand Prix. And I've got to stop because I've got a lump in my throat.
First, let's have a whistle-stop tour of Damon Hill's F1 career, because the first thing that doesn't make any sense is that his career by F1 World Champion standards was short, very short. Damon spent just 8 seasons in Formula 1 from 1992 to 1999. Now again, as far as F1 World Champions go, that is an extremely short amount of time in F1. For a modern comparison, Max Verstappen at 24 is already into his 8th season in 2022. Nico Rosberg, who we think had a relatively short career, left in 2016 after 11 seasons. And to find an F1 World Champion with 8 seasons or less, you have to go back all the way to the 1976 World Champion, James Hunt, who spent 7 years in Formula 1. As far as the teams he raced for, Damon made his Grand Prix debut in 1992 for the Brabham team, who were terrible, competing in just 2 races. Off the back of that, he would then move to Williams, who were literally the best team on the grid, being there from 1993 to 1996. He would then spend kind of a stopover season at Arrows for 1997, who were again terrible, but not quite as terrible as Brabham, before ending his career with 2 years at Jordan in 98 and 99, who were actually pretty decent. Something else that is crazy by modern standards is that at the time Damon made his F1 debut in 1992, he was 31 years old, a rookie at 31. Now, don't get me wrong, there were actually other drivers who were even older who started Grand Prix in the 90s, but those were pay drivers who literally just turned up for backmarker teams and who were never again seen when their money dried up. But Damon went on to have a proper F1 career. And when we think about in modern Formula 1, how it's completely normal that a young driver making their F1 debut should be in their early 20s and can even be teenagers, a proper driver making their debut at 31 is just nuts. Originally, Damon was picked up in 1991 as purely a test driver by Frank Williams to help develop their car. By 1992, although Damon was still a test driver and actually impressing the team with his speed, he knew that he needed some kind of Grand Prix experience. It was through this relationship with Williams that he was able to join the struggling Brabham team mid-season, who by this point were hanging on financially by the skin of their teeth. Their car, however, was so slow that they could barely even qualify to race. Back in the late 80s and early 90s, as many as 30 cars tried to qualify for a race. But because back then there simply wasn't enough grid slots, and the tracks couldn't accommodate that many cars, if you didn't qualify in the top 26 on the Saturday, you could not start the race at all. In 8 races, Damon managed to qualify just twice, in Silverstone and the Hungaroring. And to give you an example of just how slow the Brabham was, in Silverstone the gap between Damon in 26th and Nigel Mansell on pole was 7.2 seconds. In the 2 races that he actually did get to start, he went on to finish in 16th in Britain and 11th in Hungary, which in that car was a pretty impressive performance. Unfortunately for Brabham, Hungary would be it. The once great team ran out of money, going bankrupt, and that would be that for Damon's rookie season. But even so, going into a backmarker team mid-season with no testing of the car, just being thrown in at the deep end, Damon actually made a really good impression given the circumstances. And now, in the eyes of Frank Williams, he had shown impressive pace as their test driver, and now had some Grand Prix experience as well. For 1993, in controversial fashion, which I'm not going to get into too much, Williams signed Alain Prost, who was out of F1 in 1992 after taking a sabbatical, after being sacked by Ferrari the year before. He replaced Mansell, who literally, for Williams, just dominated 1992. But after winning his championship, there was a disagreement between him and Frank about money. Now, to throw an even bigger spanner into the mix, Ayrton Senna in 1992 told Frank that he would drive for Williams for free. However, nobody knew at the time that even as early as mid-1992, Prost was already signed for 93, and the only thing Prost had in his contract was that Senna couldn't be his teammate. Three all-time great drivers were on Frank's doorstep wanting to drive his cars. Prost was already signed, and adding either Mansell or Senna into that mix would be all sorts of chaos. Frank had his number one driver in Prost. He just needed someone who would do a solid job and wouldn't cause too much trouble. Up steps Damon Hill. As the team's test driver, he knew the cars very well, having helped develop them, and he now had some Grand Prix experience as well. He was also British and had a legendary name, which commercially all went into the equation for Frank. Just like that, despite Mansell still wanting to drive and Senna begging to drive for free, Damon Hill somehow beat both of them to it. Unsurprisingly, there was a lot of pressure on Damon's shoulders, but 1993 went about as smoothly as it could have. Williams had the best car, Alain Prost won his fourth world title, and Damon Hill did a very solid job as the number two. He finished third in the championship behind Prost and Senna, scored 10 podiums out of 16 races, got two pole positions, and even scored a hat-trick of wins across Hungary, Belgium, and Monza. Across the season, he became a more confident driver and a more confident man. He proved that he belonged in F1, and more importantly, he also proved that Frank was right to trust him. Having said that, being handed the metaphorical keys to the fastest car on the grid after just two Grand Prix is still pretty insane. Maybe the modern comparison is Max's promotion to Red Bull at the beginning of his second season, but the Damon situation is like that multiplied by 10. For 1994, Ayrton Senna would replace Alain Prost. Although Alain had a contract for 94, Frank had always wanted to have Senna in one of his cars. Alain had just won his fourth title and at that point had the most wins for a driver in F1 history, and so mutually agreed to retire and make way for Senna, but Williams would have to pay out his entire 1994 salary to do so. 1994, we know, would be one of F1's darkest seasons. The Senna-Williams combination was supposed to be a new chapter in Ayrton's career, but as we all know, he would lose his life in a crash just three races into the season at the San Marino Grand Prix. The loss of Ayrton Senna is very well documented in F1. It affected the lives of so many people both in and out of the sport, but in the context of this video, how it affected Damon's life is not something that has been explored that much. When Senna died, both the team and Formula One were scrambling to try and get a big name into Senna's seat. Keep in mind that with Senna's death, there was no F1 world champion on the grid now. In the end, that second seat went backwards and forwards between a young David Coulthard and also Nigel Mansell, who at the time was racing in IndyCar. But whilst all of this was going on, Damon started winning, and even became an outsider for the championship after Schumacher was disqualified and had to miss two races mid-season. 1994 saw Damon go from the guy who was lucky to be given a chance in a top team, to being basically pushed into the team leader role out of tragedy and necessity. Now, that was a lot of pressure, but at the time, Damon said that he didn't really feel like he had the full trust of the team. He was now stepping up and carrying the team after a traumatic event, but at the same time, Frank Williams was still trying to find a driver who, in his eyes, actually could challenge for the title. In the end, 1994 would be the season where Damon became a top driver. He produced arguably the greatest race of his career at the 1994 Japanese Grand Prix, holding off Michael Schumacher to win in horribly wet conditions. And although he did famously lose the title by 1 point after a controversial crash in Adelaide, with Michael winning his first world championship, by the end, he had the respect of the team. 1995 and 1996, however, would be two seasons which just defined why Damon's career made absolutely no sense. Just when it seemed that Damon had made a breakthrough in 94, 1995 would be arguably his worst season in terms of mistakes. Although the 1995 Williams FW17 did have reliability issues throughout the season, it was a great car that many people at the time thought was actually the best on the grid. So the fact that Schumacher then went on to dominate in 95 and actually win the championship quite easily just showed how bad the season was for Damon. In Silverstone, he made a desperate lunge, crashing himself and Schumacher out of the race. In the very next race in Germany, he spun whilst leading the race and threw away a chance of the win. In Italy, he again crashed into Schumacher and again took both of them out. At the European Grand Prix, he made a clumsy error putting a wheel on a damp part of the track, which caused him to crash. And in Japan, again put a wheel on the damp part of the track, went off into the gravel, and damaged his car, which forced him to retire. Frank Williams and the team were furious. Yes, Michael Schumacher's brilliance in the Benetton was hard to beat, but this was a masterclass in how to bottle a championship in a brilliant car. Even though Damon had a contract for the following season in 96, Frank didn't even wait to see what would happen the following season. At the end of 95, he signed Heinz-Harald Frentzen early for 97 to replace Damon. And this meant that regardless of what Damon did in 96, he was out at the end of the year. So guess what he does? Well, he goes and wins the 1996 World Championship, of course. Yes, in the ultimate this is what you threw away moment, Damon Hill would go on to win the 1996 World Championship whilst simultaneously knowing that he would be fired at the end of the year for not being good enough to win a World Championship. What's also quite interesting is that Adrian Newey, who was the technical director at Williams and who was designing the best car on the grid for year after year, wasn't happy about Damon being dropped and felt that his voice was being ignored. This breakdown in trust is one of the things that made Newey leave Williams for McLaren, and whichever way you want to look at it, losing the genius that was Adrian Newey was the first domino in the fall of Williams. Regardless, Damon didn't actually find out that he was dropped until the last half of the season, and what's more crazy is that it was actually Autosport who broke the news and had decided to run a front page story of how Damon was being fired by Williams. Initially, Damon thought that it was a joke and that the media were just out to get him. But when he went to confront Frank Williams about it, he learned that it wasn't just happening, it already happened. On track, however, everything came together in 1996. But even though he won 8 races, beat Schumacher, and would leave Williams as the world champion, in a strange way, it was difficult to describe him as the best driver. Michael, in 1996, began his Ferrari project, and this opened the door of opportunity for Damon. The Ferrari F310 that Schumacher stepped into looked like an armchair and basically drove like one. Whilst his teammate Eddie Irvine got one podium all season, Michael would drive the absolute wheels off it to get 3 wins, 8 podiums, and produced a sensational drive in a wet Spanish Grand Prix to take his first victory for Ferrari. And even Damon's teammate that season, who was a rookie Jacques Villeneuve, took Damon to a title decider in his rookie season, which again just takes some of the shine off Damon's title-winning season. With limited options due to how last race of 1996 and becoming the F1 world champion, to then only just qualifying for the first race of 1997. and he described having the number one on that car as the reigning world champion as being humiliating. However, even throughout a difficult 1997, there were still moments of magic, despite only scoring points twice all season at the Hungarian Grand Prix on a track that he always ran well at, the Arrows that weekend thanks to its Bridgestone tyres and also Damon's brilliance, just came alive. He qualified third on the grid, overtook Michael Schumacher for the lead, and built up a 30-second gap as most of the top runners were struggling on their Goodyear tyres. He looked set to take one of the most improbable wins in F1 history before a hydraulics issue late on, which lost him the win on the final lap, dropping him to second in one of F1's cruelest moments of bad luck. Regardless, a podium with that car still remains as one of Hill's best ever drives, and right up there with Suzuka 94. And it just showed that when Damon had the confidence in the car, even if it was slow, and the support of the team, he was able to produce absolute magic. Damon's next move would be to Jordan, where he spent 2 years and ended his career. However, another move that was on the cards for 1998 was to McLaren to partner Hakkinen. However, the deal that Ron Dennis was willing to offer was an incentivized contract of $1 million per race win, but no basic retainer. The reason why I wanted to mention this is because, in a strange way, I think this describes the perception of Damon throughout his career. None of the really big figures at the time, even when he was already a world champion, really trusted or saw him as one of the greats. I mean, I don't think Ron Dennis ever offered Senna or Prost no salary to drive for McLaren when they joined. Needless to say, Damon didn't choose to drive for free. The last 2 years he spent with Jordan were once again a roller coaster and classic Damon Hill. 1998 would turn out to be a relatively solid year, with the highlight being winning Jordan their first ever race with a 1-2 in Spa. And he would also have a strong end to the season, finishing just off the podium in fourth in three other races. But then in 1999, and now up against the man that replaced him at Williams a few years earlier in Heinz Harald Frentzen, Damon was all at sea mentally. He struggled with the handling characteristics of the 99 car, which completely drained his confidence, whilst his teammate, in contrast, became an outsider for the world championship in the last few races. After a poor race in France, which was compounded by his teammate winning the race, he almost decided to retire mid-season. However, he did see out 1999 retiring from Formula 1, and also fittingly the last race in Japan, from what he described as mental fatigue. That brought about the end to one of the most confusing and rollercoaster careers in F1. Damon, on a personal level, was one of the most honest drivers and was also one of the first to really openly talk about mental health back when people saw it as just a weakness. But Damon was never afraid to admit his flaws. As a driver, it's really hard to fully understand how good he was. It seemed that when Damon was at his best, he truly looked like he belonged with the likes of Schumacher. When Damon was at his worst, you genuinely wondered how he was still in a race-winning car. But strangely, that vulnerability, I think that's why he was so popular. It made him relatable. Although it might be harsh, if you ranked every single F1 world champion, I think he would be quite low on that list. But it doesn't matter. He took the opportunities that were given to him, had a roller coaster of a career, and despite me making this video, I'm still trying to figure out how some of it actually happened. His career was short and sweet, but it definitely was not boring. Well, there you have it, another video in the bag. If you did enjoy this one, then don't forget to subscribe to the channel, that would be greatly appreciated, and I'll see you in the next one.